Okay.
So, a quick note before we start our presentation about the proposals for next week. It is nothing to stress about. Just a paragraph or two. I think it says 1 to 2 page.
1 to 2 page.
Double spaced.
12-point font. One-inch margins.
Yeah. So 1 to 2 pages, which is about 1 to 2 paragraphs, about what you're thinking about doing. No citations necessary.
Just don't do a PowerPoint.
No PowerPoint. Just, this is what I want to research. Here's why. I think I'm going to ask so-and-so to be my mentor, or I have a mentor.
And even though it will be videotaped, you are not committed to doing that.
Yes. You can change your mind. Many people do. All right.
Yes.
Now, Lori or Brittany, do you want to introduce?
Well, we had a question. Since Rebecca's presenting today, can we count that as her?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Awesome. Oh.
You don't have to write a separate one-page double-spaced document either.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's thought we would check. So this is Rebecca, who's worked really, really hard on her thesis, the reading and writing analyses of a highly gifted student. And she's going to tell us all about it, so whenever you're ready.
And what is she in pop right now?
A graduating senior.
Graduating senior.
She's graduating! Woo!
Yeah. And she's going to student teach in the fall.
Yeah.
Actually, I think I'm going to be in North Liberty.
Oh, yay!
Great. That'll be very interesting.
Is that a forced smile or an actual smile?
No, I'm excited because I like student teaching right now in Grantwood, and that's on the southeast side of Iowa City.
Mm-hmm.
I live on the northwest side of Coralville.
Oh,
so like today when I forgot to turn my coffee pot off,
oh,
I had to drive all the way back, turn it off, and drive all the way back.
That's painful.
So it'll be like 5 minutes. So I'm really excited. Yeah, like they said, it's the reading, writing, analyses of a highly gifted student, and so it's through the College of Ed in here. So just acknowledgments, Dr. Croft, and then Kristen Miller, Brittany Barnes, and Kathy Mosca, they've helped me with everything. So this is my abstract. I mean, I'm not going to read this word for word, but what does this mean? In simple terms, this research was based off of the lack of resources that were available to gifted, talented students and families in a way for an individual student to fill the void in their education. Just a little background, I took Block A during the summer, and that's like the reading and writing and all of those kind of classes for education, and nothing was covered for the gifted, talented students, so I really wanted to touch upon that. So my subject was Bella. So I worked with her from June 2012 to April 2013. She's 7 years old, second grade, lives in this area, and then she was identified as gifted and talented. And actually I work in the Academic Advising Center, and so her mom is an advisor there. So that's how I got in touch with them. So that was really useful to work with her. And so mine is that I have catalysts of just the importance of what I was wanting to focus on. And so, as indicated, Bella showed early signs of reading comprehension. Young gifted children not only talk and conceptualize at an advanced level, they may learn to read at age 3 or 4 as opposed to age 5 or 6. Early reading reliably differentiates between mild and high degrees of giftedness, with many exceptional readers beginning by their 3rd birthday, and continuing to build a love for reading throughout childhood. And so this is actually, I had help from Professor Baldus in this in the Bell and Blank Center, so that was awesome. When asked which books Bella had read and would like to read again, she thought The Magic School Bus, which was awesome because it had a lot of chapters, lots of small captions, so that could be very overwhelming, but it was not for her at all. And then also, she was quite fond of Roald Dahl and listed many of his books among those she would read again. As a bystander, this may seem like a non-issue, but having the memory capacity to state exact titles that were favored and above for children her age in terms of memory capacity is really awesome. And then also Bella's use of color, spatial awareness, conceptualization, vocabulary, and sarcasm were also other indicators of advancement that early childhood teachers had observed. And so that was an importance of one of my references, Davis 2011, that touched upon that, so I thought that was kind of cool. So my literature review, I think it's astonishing that 2006, over 3 million gifted and talented students were in public schools, and they talk about separation is beneficial to students who are gifted, and so we need to have more advocates for gifted and talented students, for sure. They said a study by the National Research Center on the Gifted and Talented found that many gifted students already know 40 to 50% of the material covered under the standard curriculum, suggesting the importance of exposing these children to alternate activities and resources. This is something that she was always prone to because she always knew, or she would know the majority of everything that was going on. And in addition, organizations like the National Association for Gifted Children highlight the importance of having well-trained teachers and adequate funding in order to implement programs. So I thought this was really cool too, because a lot of people don't ever think about the gifted and talented students. It's more focused on students that are might have a disability or the ones that are struggling, and so they kind of fall through the cracks, and so that's kind of a bummer. So this is something that we need advocates for. And so for my methods, I have both qualitative and quantitative, and so I'll show you in a minute. So in order to address Bella's level of intelligence, the Stanford-Binet assessment tool was used to measure her intelligence in many different categories, such as fluid reasoning, knowledge, visual spatial reasoning, and working memory. So this was first designed by a French psychologist named Alfred Binet. It was an assessment to help categorize children into grades and focus on all levels of intelligence. There was an additional mixed methods approach to research that included qualitative and quantitative research. The qualitative researchers aimed to gather an in-depth understanding of human behavior and the reasons that govern such behavior. The type of qualitative research that was used was over-the-shoulder reading assessment methods. So if you're in the College of Education, you definitely do these in a lot of your classes. Subject observation and writing prompts, which I do all the time in my student teaching right now. This is all done with the student's consent and analyzed the student's ability to comprehend, connect to the outside world, and make inferences into her work. The researcher, who's me, also examined phenomenon through quantitative observations of numerical representation and statistical analysis. I'll talk about this later. And then this was illustrated in the miscue analysis, so I don't know if you're familiar with that, but that will be there later. Along with the questionnaires to the people, there is statistical representation of the findings of the study. Interviews with the respondents and experts in this field were also conducted. So this was started as in my Block A class, excuse me. And so over here is the observations and examples. And so this is unbiased information. And then over here is my interpretations of what happened. And then I used different types of reading materials to base my findings. So right here, I actually used the literacy crisis and multilingual classrooms a lot in this reading writing profile. It's actually probably like 20 pages, so but this is just a little excerpt. And then at the bottom it's just recommendations of what I would see fit to fill that void of what is happening in the observations and what is actually happening in the classroom. So this is the statistical information. So the syntax and semantics. So it was either that it was yes acceptable or no acceptable, and then the meaning change. So if something was changed when she's reading, did it really change the story, or did it just kind of just slightly move the sentence around? And then graphic similarity, and then retelling, which I thought she did an absolutely awesome job retelling, which is awesome because I'm working actually with kindergartners right now, so they're about two grades under her, but a lot of people, or a lot of children have difficulty retelling stories, so I think that's definitely something to take note of. So this is actually one of her writing samples. So this was last summer, and as you can see, there's kind of like a beginning, middle, and end. There's capitalization. This is her mother actually typed this up for me along with other samples, and this is, other than seeing her handwriting, this is exactly what it was. So my spell check on my computer hated it though, but. And then the identification of natural abilities. So there's subcategories of interpersonal, environmental development, mental process, chance of talent. So this is definitely important to take into consideration just because there's so many different variables in this. Just kind of a background on Bella. She was initially tested going into first grade to see her natural learning abilities. The results indicated that Bella excels in intellectual abilities, creativity, and physical fine motor skills. This was illustrated in the test findings, as well as interactions with Bella and her past work, located later in the appendix. So if you've read that, if that's online.
Rebecca?
Yeah.
So was this the Stanford Binet? Is that the assessment that she took?
Yes.
And did she have to have that done here or at another private?
If she was through a private school, so preschool.
Okay, because I was going to say, one of the problems in our area education agency is that it's almost impossible to get a Stanford Binet administered.
An EIQ test, because it's frowned upon in Iowa's current.
Our version of RTI.
Yeah.
So that's, I was really curious to know how they managed to get a Stanford Binet administered.
I don't exactly know how they got it, but.
You just go in and
Yeah, they had already done
pay for it.
So, yeah, and then afterwards, it kind of, I talked about that in the chance, how she's younger, so it's probably going to change.
It will.
And I mean, it's not very concrete.
But
yet,
it was still
so.
Information that could have been helpful, and the Iowa City Public Schools will not use test results that were not, that come from any other office. So even though they have this, usually the school district will not make use of the findings. So.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, no problem. So she's in the top 10% of her grade nationally on average. And so she does struggle with working with her peers in group activities or alongside others. So she works really well with older students,
mm-hmm.
not so much people her own age. And so that's actually really interesting. And also she has an older sister. So sometimes they think that the oldest is the one that usually is with the parents all the time and they'll, you know, get along better with older people, but actually it's the youngest. And so, with her outstanding abilities that manifest creative and productive thinking, Bella also excels with task-oriented skills. And then also her flow skills to finish a project that's talked about by Professor Baldus. Like, she is able to just concentrate, get in her own world, and finish the project, which a lot of like attention capacity is not that high at that age. So intelligence testing, like I said, she's in the top 10% of these. And so this was formally assessed about 12 months ago. And so the psychologist stated that that because Bella was only 7 years of age when she did the testing, there's no certainty that her IQ score would be the same when she's tested years later. So that's kind of, it's great that they did that and awesome for my research, but. We'll see how it goes. So the developmental process. So I definitely worked with differentiated instruction, the formative assessments, and the content area literacy. So with my educational background and future classroom, I know many students will need differentiated instructions along with supplemental activities. I don't know if any of you guys have been in Pratcom yet, but we actually do that every day. So we make sure that all the students at different levels are worked and challenged. And this was to fill the void of a conflicting research and create a clearer picture for myself as well as others who are interested in this. So I kind of came up with some ideas through this, and so I didn't know if you want to make this interactive. If you can think of any ways that for differentiating instruction, how this can be helpful. Is anyone happy with this? It could be something simple. An example would be independent study.
I went to the Foundations of Mainstreaming yesterday and told them, gave them the whole gifted spiel. And I had asked if somebody could give an example of kind of along these lines. And we were talking about enrichment. And there was a young man in there who was talking about offering a supplemental program. I can't even tell you exactly what it was, because he offers this program and it has to do with the beginning shapes that form Japanese characters. And so kids take this just as something fun that they want to learn because it's cool Japanese stuff. So you can, I guess if students are really doing well in their own language, you can do some enrichment with comparing it to other languages. But this one was just, I guess Japanese characters maybe are a little bit like Chinese characters. And so it seemed amazing.
Yeah, that is really interesting. There is definitely a lot of different kinds of things that you can do with this. I kind of touch upon them. So I just know from my past experience and also like during Pratcom, learning contracts, own just depends on the situation. Independent study, learning centers. I do this every day with my kindergartners for 45 minutes in different groups. And so we have lit hubs, we have listening to reading, we do the daily five, that sort of thing. So you could definitely do that, and it could be individually too. So if you were tutoring or something like that. Anchor activities are definitely important. They could be done either way. Discovery, learning, inquiry. I learned through this through Block B science methods, and now I base all of my teaching philosophies off of this. So I think that's definitely the hands-on and the experiences are what's going to teach the students the most. And then alternate assessments, obviously. So then I talk about chance and talent. And so when chance was first introduced, many variables such as age, culture, socioeconomic status, and motivation were seen as a way to easily change results. In terms of methodology, factors in chance were looked over closely, but could only hold so much weight to the overall research and findings. It's important to consider, as a parent educator, a supportive approach to support Bella's overall abilities and giftedness in the wider world to retain Bella's passion for learning and motivation to learn. So making sure not to be overbearing and make her not want to learn, that's definitely a kind of a tightrope to be on. And then talent, she shows perseverance in activities that she enjoys. She likes to ask many questions about why and how things work. When compared with the average child, the thinking process of gifted children are quick and logical. They are naturally curious, love inquiry, and have a passion to learn. Gifted students can be continuously asking questions, and the simple one-word answer is not always enough to satisfy the wondering child. So this is awesome to tutor her, work with her, and that sort of thing. So in conclusion, an area that has possible variables that cannot be accounted for were the subjects, IQ, intrinsic motivation, factors, and peer pressure from others. Like I said, she has an older sister. Her older sister's about 18, so that's definitely a big influence on her. And then also, it's important to focus on the overall picture when working with children that are gifted and talented, because they're growing and developing each day. And in conclusion, it's crucial to recognize gifted children for who they are and build a strong foundation for them at an early age to reach their full potential. So these are some of my references. I have 2 pages of references, but these are the ones that are in this PowerPoint. And then I think I have questions that people posted on the somewhere on the discussion board. Okay. Did you have to go through IRB? not really, because I kind of did it backwards. So I did the research first and then I took the class. So it's all flip-flop. So actually I took the IRB this semester.
And so she can never publish this. She can never, you know, even if she did research later on pertaining to this, you'd have to go through IRB, get parental permission then. Mm-hmm. Then it would be really hard to come back and reference your earliest research.
Right, exactly. What challenges did you face in the research and process? Like I said, I did this backwards, but I mean, I'm really glad that I did it. But yeah, that was definitely a challenge. Writing the paper, APA style, really got me. And then did you choose to use the Stanford test or did the school? So the parents actually chose it. They were the ones that started that. So.
Well, the psychologist. They yes. wanted their child assessed and the psychologist thought that
right,
would be the
right.
most appropriate.
So that was done through that process. Does anyone have any other questions?
You mentioned that she didn't seem to be especially successful playing with children her own age, mm-hmm. but she was more successful playing with children who were older. Mm-hmm. Besides the fact that she has an older sister, can anybody think of any other reason why she might be more comfortable with older children rather than children her own age?
I remember she's really smart.
Yeah, just like
intellectual.
Well, you said she's not very successful at playing with her peers. Mm-hmm. But my contention would be she is successful playing with her peers. It's just her peers are not her age
right.
mates. Because if you have an IQ of 145 or advanced to something, because whether it stays that particular number or not, that's so different than the rest of her age mates. That's so different than the other kids her own age. So it would be like asking you, course, you guys are becoming teachers, and in many ways you're going to be doing this, but it would be like asking you to spend your days playing with elementary school children. Like I said, you will be doing that. But so we're asking her to fit in with people with whom she doesn't really fit. And
right.
So, you know, they probably should also use something like the Iowa Acceleration Scale and determine if she would actually benefit from whole grade acceleration. So
yeah, they were struggling with that, but they kind of wanted her to, they were concerned that later on when she is 18 and maybe some of her peers do catch up, that she'll...
They'll never catch
her
up.
Peers are never going to catch up. She's never going to have age mates. Well, my daughter finally did, working on her doctoral program. But it's a difference. It's just a difference. I visited a school once when I'd only been here for a year or two, and somebody said, when do these kids get to be normal? You know, and that kind of made me jump. And I said, well, do you have African-American kids here? I mean, it's a little bit like asking, when does that black child get to be white? But they didn't have any African-American kids, so I don't think they really understood that. But they did, certainly didn't. I mean, so they don't, the other kids don't catch up. She's an Olympian, and she may hide it. She can choose to hide it, and it may look like other people have caught up, but if instead she's given the proper development, then is anybody ever going to catch up with Michael Phelps in terms of swimming?
Right. Yeah, that's...
So, but this was fabulous. Even if you did go about it totally backwards, it really was. And you worked with somebody who was teaching over the summer. That's how you got into the particular project, right?
Right, yeah. So I started all the information beforehand. So I did all the research, then I wrote the paper, and then I took a class.
Yeah. And it just was too good. The research itself was too good to not, you know, really maximize the value of that. And you've worked really, really hard to pound it into shape. So...
So Rebecca is now going to go to do her student teaching after she has completed and turned in her thesis. So it'll be one less thing she has to worry about.
Yes, it was turned in last week. Everything signed. So.
So how excited are you about this?
So excited.
Speaks again to Ian's point from last week of do everything early before you student teach. Make it happen.
Right.
Rebecca's living proof that it can happen.
And really, what would be even more instructive, well, you saw Ian, but if you could see her probably in about her second to third week of student teaching, that's when you'd really get it. Because you'll be just dragging a teeny bit. Because it's really tiring.
Well, I mean, the first 2-3 weeks you're in workshops until like 8 to 5 every day, just listening to speakers, and then after that, you're going to be student teaching, so you'll be 8 to 5, and going from a college student that it's like, all right, 1 o'clock nap time, you know, so it'll definitely be different.
That's a good note.
And lesson plans. And
are you working, you've got to be working on your endorsement.
For gifted talent?
Mm-hmm.
No.
But you took Dr. Baldus's class.
I've taken about half of them.
Okay.
So after she graduates and she's free, then she'll come back to work with the new me, whoever is in this space, because that will be long gone.
Yeah.
Happily graduated, employed.
Unless there was some way I could keep you from graduating.
I
guess that would be as of now, I have my reading, language arts, and social science. And then I'm 9 credits away from teaching math K-12. And then my gifted and talented endorsement, I have about 6 left.
And I just love it that you already have these, you know, insights into what this little girl needed. And I will tell you that my daughter, who left high school, she's the one that made a 34 on the ACT at the age of 14, left high school at the age of 15, and her, you know, her sister likes to call her a high school dropout, but it doesn't really matter because she just finished her PhD. We had her assessed by a private psychologist because we wanted her to be able to start at a school for gifted kids. And I think they assessed her IQ at somewhere around, it was a nice, mild, positive 128.
which, and she was probably, she was, yeah, she was probably about six, and she's very shy and reserved. And you were right, because her IQ clearly is way above
126. Way above it, yeah.
But, so for them to have found a 145, it's really not likely that they dramatically over-assess that little girl's ability. It's, I mean, it may waffle just a little bit, but you don't find a youngster with an IQ at that level, and then suddenly they're back to practically normal.
So where they did choose a tool that is not the most...
as stable, right?
Stable tool out there.
But, yeah. But I'm glad you have that experience. And
mm-hmm.
So
your experience was definitely worth all of it.
Your student teaching will be in what grade?
I think second. So this is where she was at.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I am excited. I'm a preschool teacher, so then I was in kindergarten this semester.
Do you know what school in Northwood?
I think Penn. So yeah, it will be exciting.
Does that mean you've been in Penn?
I know where it is.
No, I've been in. I work with a first grader who would be in second grade, but she's at.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Well, we're not officially supposed to know until May 5th.
Oh, okay.
But someone that's in my sorority, her aunt is going to be my teacher.
Oh, that's
nice. So my resume, mm-hmm. and she's like, do you know this person? And mm-hmm. she's like, well.
That's great.
Let me tell you a secret.
Insider information. We'll never tell, and it's not that
yeah.
it's on.
She's like, don't tell, and I'm like, guess what? But,
that's great.
No, it's on.
Having this moment of.
No, it's, don't worry, the video's there, it's fine.
So,
well, that's really great.
Anybody else have anything they want to share?
Emily, I didn't realize you were part of the Reimagining Downtown project until I saw your face in a video today.
I have no idea what that means.
Okay, never mind. It looks just like you have. You have a mystery.
I've heard that. A doppelganger?
I've heard
you
that.
Have a mystery.
Like, How I Met Your Mother?
Yes. I have one. Do you have like a mystery twin on?
Don't know what
I
mean.
That's
so cool. What is the reimagining?